To this tutorial, I have the pleasure to introduce the speaker. Her name is Véronique Cortier. She comes from Nancy, and she's one of the leading researchers in security. She is worldwide famous for her contributions in theoretical aspects of security in a broad sense. In particular, she worked quite a lot on the analysis of cryptographic protocols. And today she is going to touch on a specific aspect, which is the compositionality of security protocols, which is particularly challenging, intriguing. So it's very nice to have a tutorial on that. And without further ado, your audience.
Thank you, Matteo, for this introduction. Really embarrassing one, actually. So since it is supposed to be a tutorial, I start with a gentle introduction to security protocols and formal methods. So for those who already attend typically this afternoon post session, maybe you can just do some emails during 30 minutes and then I will wake up you so that you can enter the talk. And for the other ones, so this is supposed to be a tutorial for the entire ETAPS, so you don't need to have followed the post conferences for this tutorial. So what I'm going to talk about is security protocols, also called cryptographic protocols. So it's still about verifying programs, but a particular type of programs, which are cryptographic protocols, small programs that aims at securing communication. So there are many examples, and what they really aims at depend on the application. So example is payment, for example, so payment by credit card, or pay-per-view, when you want to see a movie and pay and see it once or twice. There are also security protocols on your mobile phone to authenticate your communication, make sure you'll pay, you will pay in the end. And other applications are electronic voting or health, some health card. So how does it work from a very high level? So the protocol is describe how each party should behave. So it's really a program. How each party should behave in order to obtain the goal. And it's called cryptographic protocol because these programs typically use cryptography, encryption, signature, hash, and sometimes more complex cryptography. So a famous example, not just famous, but an example that you're using every day is the TLS protocol. So this is the S of your HTTP, when you have the HTTPS, so the secure mode. And so it's an old protocol now. It has been first implemented in 94. There are various implementations depending on which browser you are using. There are also implementation for others, not just for browsers. And you probably already heard about bugs and attacks. So there is, for example, the Heartbleed attacks, which was due to some memory overflow, or the go-to-fail attacks due to some missing checks on the Mac browser. And one particular attack, which I found quite funny, is the Freak attack. So as you may know, some in the old time, it was the size of the key was something that was legally fixed. So it was, for example, in the United States, during some time, for any communication between the United States and abroad, you had to use small keys being 512 bits keys. Why small? Why? Probably because then the NSA could already break this kind of keys. So for those of you that are old enough, you remember these times where you have to set up properly the size of the key so that you could communicate with the United States. So these old days are over now. You can use any size of key to communicate, not any size of key, but at least a higher key to communicate worldwide. But, you know, I mean, programs always keep the old version for compatibility reasons. So it's still possible to use this mode, which is called RSA export mode, where you can, when you use small keys. And so when your browser starts a communication with some remote server, say Amazon or Google, then there is a negotiation. So your browser says, OK, I support this and this and these protocols. And at the end, for example, the RSA export mode. And the server would say, OK, on my side, I can support this and these protocols. And servers typically offer even very low security mode for compatibility reasons and for make sure that everyone can connect. And so what Kartik Bhargavan and his team showed is that actually an active attacker in the middle between your browser and the remote server could just fake this negotiation phase where he could trick the server believing that you are offering only the RSA export mode. And so the server would accept it. And then your server would think that the server is only accepting the RSA export mode. So you would be both communicated on this very degraded mode. And the funny story is that so many servers were actually flawed. So the attacks would work on many of the servers, including the NSA website. So this is like going the history going back to them. And there are many, many other attacks found on TLS protocols like Logjam or Sloat. And you can learn on these attacks going to the site of Kartik Bhargavan, for example. There are many explanations. It's quite interesting. Another example of a protocol that you are using not every day, but it's a very practical example, is a biometric passport. So I guess most of you have a passport. And on it, there is a chip that contains secure information, so your identity and your birth date, nationality, blah, blah, blah. And the first goal of your passport is to make sure that no one can fake, forge a passport. But the second goal is also to preserve your privacy. So I should not be able to read your identity and the birth date and so on. And I should not be able to track you, because you are wearing a passport. So there is really these two goals in mind when the protocols have been designed. And actually, it doesn't work so well. So interestingly, during a couple of years, the French passports, and not the other ones, had an attack because the programmers wanted to be more precise than the specification. And they were using two different error messages. So because your passport may refuse a communication for several reasons, either because it's not the right key, either because it's an old message, too old message. And they were using two different error messages to distinguish these two cases. And because of these two distinct error messages, then it was possible to track you by replaying messages, and depending on the error, I could know whether it's you or someone else. So it was not really specified in the implementation that you have to use always the same error message, and the French implementation was flawed, actually. And this attack still remains, but it's more difficult to mount on all passports by measuring precisely how much time your passport need to refuse a communication. So these two examples of real case protocols. And why are they typically difficult to analyze? Because they are not big. I mean, it's not huge programs like the programs Kim Larson was describing this morning. It's smaller program with a couple of actions. And they are difficult to analyze. Because it's not just the programs that you need to analyze, but it's the program in the context of a hostile environment, so an attacker that may read and intercept any message on the network, that may, of course, forge and send messages, if you wish, and maybe the attacker may also be a legitimate participant of some protocols. For example, maybe I'm an attacker, I also have my own passport, and maybe I'm going to use it to mount an attack against you. So in the last 20, even now 30 years, many flaws have been discovered. And the problem with this security protocol is that it's difficult and costly to fix, like many programs, actually, because they are embedded, and so you're not going to change all passports. And even for the TLS, so it's not that difficult to update browsers. But as exemplified by the RSA export, the freak attack, old version remains for compatibility reasons. So as soon as some buggy version has occurred, it's difficult to erase it from the networks. It's often the case that old version of TLS still remains just for backward compatibility. So whenever possible, it's possible to have guarantees before deploying your protocols. And formal methods have been quite helpful by providing rigorous models and proofs and finding flaws. And so I'm going to first present which kind of models we need to use to model protocols and find attacks. So there are many models, almost one model per paper. But one common characteristic of this form symbolic models for protocols is the representation of messages. So in reality, the messages are just bit strings. They are using cryptography, so they are it's using group theory, it's using discrete log, and so ever. But in symbolic models, they are abstracted away by terms. So I guess most of you know what term is, and if not, then it's you can think of it as a labeled graph, which means that we don't abstract messages by an atomic data. We don't keep the whole math. We keep the structure of the messages abstracted as a term. So for example, if we have for the message, which is the encryption of a pair of the name of an agent, A, some random number, a nonce, NA, encrypted with some key K, we'll just abstract it as a term rooted by a symbol, ANC, so just a symbol representing encryption, which has two sons. The left son is a pair, so just a label pair, of, again, two sons, a leaf for an atomic data, which is the identity of the agent, so it's an atom, A, and the random nonce, the random value NA, it's also abstracted away by an atomic data, NA. And then the right son of the root symbol is, again, a leaf, K. So we just remember the structure of the message. And then we need to reflect some of the properties of the cryptography. And the very basic property, for example, for encryption, is that you can decrypt an encrypted messages. So for this, we consider an equality, which says that if you decrypt the encryption of X by Y, so if you decrypt it by Y, then you get X. Okay, and you can add more equation if you wish, like for example for concatenation, if you project on the first component the concatenation of X and Y, then you get X, and you project on the second component, you get Y. Then you have a similar equation for asymmetric encryption. And so in these formal symbolic models, we either consider a fixed equational series for just the standard primitives, encryption, pair, signature, and so on, or we can also try to have just a general equational theory, so which is just a relation between terms. Other example of equational theories are, for example, the theory of the exclusive OR, so which is used in cryptography, for example, for transmitting secret. Maybe I should not move this. So I should switch like this? Okay. So for the exclusive OR, we'll not reflect the whole property of the exclusive OR, but at the very least, we'll reflect the fact that exclusive OR is associative. So if you have X plus Y dot Y plus Z, then it's X XOR Y XOR Z. It's also commutative. X XOR Y is equal to Y XOR X. And X XOR X is zero.
So all of those who knows about rewriting theory, you see that this theory is associative and commutative, and we are probably getting already into trouble. So it's not always that you can we can consider this kind of theories. So then the game is to consider as wide equational theories as we can, so that we can model as much primitives as we can, but it's not always the case that we can consider any equational theory. Okay, and another another theory of interest for us is the Diffie-Hellman theory, where you want at least to model the fact that so in Diffie-Hellman you want at least to model the fact that you can switch the you it's an exercise. Thank you. So in Diffie-Hellman, when you do a Diffie-Hellman exchange, you're using modular exponentiation. So modular exponentiation have a lot of properties, of course. And at the very least, for the exchange to work, you want to reflect the fact that z to the x to the y is equal to z to the y to the x. And you may add more theory. The more we can consider, the better. So now that we have this model for messages, so terms, plus an equational theory that model our primitives, we can start to analyze our first protocols. So let's consider a simple protocol where Bob starts the communication. So, yeah, so for those who don't know, we have two actors always in security protocols, which are Alice and Bob. These are our two main characters. Then Charlie is typically the bad guy. So Bob starts communicating with Alice, and he says, okay, so I'm Bob, and here our key K, okay? And then Alice responds to Bob by saying, okay, I'm Alice, and I'm sending a secret S encrypted by a key K. So is this protocol secure? Well, no, because the key has been sent in clear, so then the attacker can just see the key, then he'll wait for the second messages, and he can just decrypt it. Right? So how do we formally reflect this? So out of the second message, which is Alice and the encryption of S with K, you can obtain just the plain encryption. And formally, this is by projecting. And from the first message, where he got Bob and the key K, he can get the key K by just projecting on the second component. So now that he has the encryption and the key, he can just decrypt it and get the secret. And so applying just function and using the equational theory, this reduces to S. And as a notation, we'll use this V dash to say that S is deducible, the secret is deducible from the two messages, Bob and the key, and Alice and S encrypted with the key. Okay, so this protocol is insecure just by, you don't need an active attacker here, you just need an attacker that reads the messages and just then try to deduce the secret. Okay, so now we want to have something more active to reflect the behavior of the protocols. So here it's where the zoo of models become really large. So I'm just going to present one type of model, which is using process algebra. So here it is the applied pile calculus. So it's a small abstract programming language where you have so it's a small grammar just to model your protocol. So you have a primitive that say you can input on channel C something that will be stored on X. You can output on channel C a term T and then proceed. You have the if then else. The bar is to model parallel composition. So if you have P running in parallel with Q, because in protocols you have many programs, you have the program of Alice, the program of Bob, the program of the server, all this running in parallel. Then this bang P is to model the fact that P is replicated an arbitrary number of times. So this is P parallel P parallel P parallel P, as many as you want. And we have a new NP, which is to typically model nonce, freshness. So it's a new constant, a new name, a fresh one. So the scope of N is restricted to P. So for those who are not familiar with security models for security protocols, this really looks like the PI calculus or the CSP language, except that instead of atomic messages, we now consider terms, not just atom or names like in the PI calculus. And equalities are interpreted up to the equational theory. So a very famous, at least for educational purpose, protocol is the Needham-Schroeder protocol. So it's a simple protocol which aims at authenticated Alice towards Bob and Bob towards Alice. So for this, Alice simply sends a message to Bob saying, "Hello, I'm Alice. Here is a fresh nonce, NA, so it's just a randomly generated number, encrypted with the public key of Bob." So then Bob should just decrypt the message, copy blindly the nonce from Alice because it's something fresh and random, so no information about it. And then Bob adds his own nonce, NB, and encrypt everything with the public key of Alice. So what's the why? What's the aim? The aim is that at the last step, when Alice receives the message, she decrypts it and she can recognize her nonce. So here the idea is that Alice is challenging Bob. Alice is sending Bob a nonce, NA, encrypted with the public key of Bob. So only Bob can decrypt it, because only Bob has a private key associated to his public key. So now that Alice sees her nonce back, she knows that Bob was here. So this Bob has completed her challenge. So Alice knows that she's talking to Bob. And the symmetric part is that Alice replies by copying Bob's nonce. And this was the challenge for Alice. So now Bob is convinced, since that Bob's nonce NB was sent encrypted with the public key of Alice, only Alice was able to decrypt it. So now Bob is convinced that he is talking to Bob. So actually there is a flaw, but I leave this as an exercise and you'll find it's not an easy one because it was a protocol that was quite well studied and it took 17 years to find the flaw. So it's not an easy one, but now it's easy to find it on the internet, for example. But how to model this protocol? So here, this is, what is tricky about protocol is that it's very simple, okay? Three messages, small ones, but actually it's not one program, it's already two programs, because there is a point of view of Alice, what she's going to do, and the point of view of Bob, what he's going to do. So when you model the Needham-Schroeder protocol, you need not to model one program, but two. So you have two processes. So in our small languages, this goes as follows. You will model the role of Alice, the role of the initiator, as follows. We'll say, okay, Alice will just generate some nonce. So we have this new NA. Then Alice outputs some term corresponding to the first messages. And then when it's more interesting, it's what Alice is supposed to do when she receives the message. When she receives the message, so anything, Alice doesn't know in advance what she's going to receive. Then she decrypts it, so she decrypts what she receives. She decrypts X with her private key. And then she checks that the first component of what she receives is equal to her nonce. And if that's the case, then she retrieves the second component and send back to Bob, encrypted with the public key of Bob. Okay, and similarly, we have a process for Bob. And then the whole model of the protocol is the two processes of Alice, so the process of Alice, an unbounded number of times, because Alice may try to communicate several times. You are running the TLS protocols every day, many times. And the role of B, again, many times. And because we want to reflect an attacker that is powerful enough, we're going to give to the attacker the public key of Alice, the public key of Bob. Okay, this is actually not enough, because we want really to consider a powerful attacker that could be part of the protocol. So we will also consider the fact that Alice may talk to Charlie. So you may visit websites that you don't trust. It's not because you are visiting a website that you don't trust that you are So even if you are visiting a website that you don't trust, this website should not be able to take advantage of this to, for example, connect yourself to another website that you do trust. Okay, it's not because you contact website, I don't know, untrusted website, that this website should be able to do something on your behalf to Amazon, say. So we'll consider that Alice may also talk to Charlie, and Bob may also talk to Charlie. And here, Charlie is a dishonest participant, so it's the attacker. So we'll give to the attacker the corresponding private key. So this is a typical model of the Needham-Schroeder protocol. We can also consider the case where Alice is played by Bob. So the initiator role is played by Bob talking to A, Bob talking to C, and so on. So this, now we are done. We have model for messages, the model of the protocol. So what remains is to model the property. So we have this nice model, this nice process. What do you want to prove about it? So we want to prove some property. And again, what makes it different with a typical program verification is that we don't just want to prove that P satisfies our property. We want to prove that our program satisfies our property for any attacker that could be put in parallel. So we want to show that our program is preserved, I don't know, authentication, secrecy. And even if it is put in parallel with any other programs that try to interfere with, the property. So we can typically consider trace properties, so something bad never occurs. So for example, secrecy, we can try to prove that for any attacker, P in parallel with the attacker will not disclose some secret S. We may also want to model some authentication property. So for this, we need a small logic. So for authentication, we need typically something like if Bob finishes having talked to Alice, then Alice has indeed finished or started a session talking to Bob. So it's a correspondence property. So for this, we typically use events. So we enrich the language with events. And we'll have property of the form if the event Bob has finished talking with A, then it should be the case that Alice has begun with talking to B. Okay, and they may even share the same noun, the same key. So we typically model authentication using a small logic. And the good news is that for this kind of model and this kind of properties, the field is now quite mature, and we have many procedures to decide secrecy authentication for a variety of cryptographic primitives, so at least the standard ones, encryption, signature, concatenation, MAC, and so on, and also sometimes more complex properties like exclusive OR, bland signature. And it's not just theoretical results. We have automatic tools. The most used nowadays are Proverif, CITER, Avispa, Tamarin, and it's a very active research domain, so just go to the post, either today or tomorrow. You will see mini talks on how to improve, have more procedures, cover more cases, more protocols. So, just what I told you is that, okay, the field is mature. We have many tools that successfully analyze hundreds of protocols. We find flaws like the Needham-Schroeder flaws. We find flaws like the freak attacks on the TLS protocol. So it's just a fairy tale. So you come with your protocol and we analyze it and we're done. Well, not exactly. So first, as I said, still a very active research domain, which means that not everything is done. And what I'm going to talk about here, more specifically, is composition. So for this, consider an imaginary discussion between an app designer and a security expert. And so imagine that the app designer first discussed his application design with a security expert. As I said, it's an imaginary discussion, okay? So it's not supposed to be realistic that an app designer first go to a security expert. So the app designer comes and says, oh, okay, I wish to design a cool application for mobile payments, so I need clients to authenticate. So the security expert would probably say, yeah, okay, I mean, authentication, we have protocols, even formally proof protocols. Use some password-based protocol. Okay, okay, good. I also need secure communication between the mobile and the bank. You know, these things have to be secure somehow. Okay, yeah, yeah, no problem. Use some secure channel. I mean, TLS is typically done for this. Okay, great, great. I need to make sure that my clients are talking to the bank. Yeah, I mean, use some PK infrastructure. It's done for this. Okay, I mean, that's really cool. I mean, you guys have many protocols that are formally proven, so I can just pick anything I want and just plug them together and it will work. Huh. No, we don't know, actually. So can we compose these protocols? Because we do have secure password-based protocols. We do have secure protocols that implement secure channels. We do have PKI infrastructures that are reasonable. We don't have actually guarantees that we can just pick any building blocks we want and plug them together, as typically a protocol designer would like to do. So if you want to build your protocol using all these building blocks, you typically have two options. The first option is you select the building blocks that you want to consider, so your favorite password-based authentication protocol, your PKI infrastructure, your some secure channel implementation. This yields one protocol, and you can use the tools to analyze it. The issue is that the tools doesn't scale so well. So if you get huge protocols, then probably the tools will have really hard time to prove your protocol secure or to find flaws. The other issue is that it's not very modular. I mean, an app designer typically doesn't care about which password-based protocols will be exactly used. And as soon as you change or just update the protocols, then you would need to reanalyze the whole thing. So this would be very costly. So the option two would be really to have guarantees that as soon as some protocols, I don't know, a key exchange or a secure channel protocol achieves some guarantees, then you can use it as you think you could. So as a warm-up, first consider parallel composition. So here you don't, it's simple composition, it's just you have some protocol P using some key, another protocol Q using some other keys, and you'd like to share keys. Because, for example, P and Q, you may want to use your public key in two protocols. I don't know, to encrypt your emails and also to sign, for example. Or you may want your public key to be used in two applications. So can you do this safely? So consider a very simple protocol that just encrypts with your public key, okay? And the question is that, the protocol is Alice sends to Bob a secret S encrypted with Bob's public key. Very simple. And the question is, does S remain confidential, secret? So if you consider just this simple protocol, then yes. But now you are using another protocol, and this protocol is also very reasonable. It's a challenge protocol. So Alice sends to Bob some challenge, a nonce, encrypted with Bob's public key. And then she receives, then Bob replies with the nonce of Alice. So it just to show that he was able to decrypt, so Bob is there. So it's a reasonable protocol where a simple authentication protocol where Alice makes sure that Bob is alive, typically. So this protocol is reasonable, but of course, if you compose both protocols, so if you use the same public key in protocol one and protocol two, then it's a disaster. Because this second protocol, protocol two, runs as a decryption oracle, okay? Is B is going to, so whatever you send to B, encrypted, you get it in clear. Okay? So the fact that it is encrypted is not very useful anymore, because what the attacker can do, for example, is take the first message, so the encryption of the secret with the public key of Bob, send this to Bob as a challenge, and Bob would just return S in the clear. Okay? So you have this decryption oracle together with an encryption protocol, and it breaks. So a typical countermeasure is to tag protocol. So if you want to share keys, you should not encrypt anything with the key and decrypt anything with the key. You should make sure that you are able to recognize from which protocol the packets come from. So for example, going back to our two toys protocols, the protocol one should say, okay, I'm encrypting, but I am protocol one. So everything that I encrypt, I put my name, protocol one, in front of it. And similarly for protocol two, for anything that I encrypt or sign or everything, I put my name, protocol two, inside my encryption. So now the protocol two would decrypt anything that starts with encryption protocol two, something encrypted with the public key of B. And now you can safely compose at least these two protocols. So to avoid interference with between protocols, you should put the name of the protocol inside each encryption or sign packet. Okay, this is not the only issue. The second issue is even more stupid, is that the second protocol may reveal some keys. So for example, imagine that the second protocol just sent out B's private key. This is, of course, a very bad idea. Then clearly, protocol P2 completely messes up with the security of protocol 1. Okay, and if Bob sends out his private key, the security of S in the first protocol is no longer guaranteed. So this yields the second condition, which is that, okay, you may compose protocols, they may share keys, provided that they don't reveal each other keys. So the keys that are shared are not revealed by the other protocols. And this is actually sufficient. So the first result that we can get as a composition is that if you have a protocol alone in isolation, P1, that preserves some secrecy, for example, then and that has some key K, then you can put in parallel any other protocols that is also using the same key, and P1 parallel P2 will still preserve the secrecy of S, provided that they are tagged, and they don't have the same tag, and provided that the shared keys, long-term keys, are not revealed. Okay. So now consider a more complex scenario, where it's not just P and Q are not just composed in parallel, but Q is actually using P inside as a sub-protocols. And here, this is typically for key exchange. Okay, so P is going to establish a key for Q, and Q is going to use it. Okay, so it's not just, since there is many session interleaving, it's some P may run, then Q going to use it, then there might be a new session of P, and Q is going to use the new key in the new session, and so on. So consider again a simple example. So P is some generic key establishment protocol, so it's P1, and at the end, it establishes a key, T1. So Alice is going to have T1 as a key, stored in some variable Z1. And the Bob is going to, at the end of the protocol, know some key stored in Z2. It's supposed to be T2. This is an exchange, so we don't know in advance which values. It will depend on the interaction. And Q is going to use the key to encrypt, okay? So it's just, Q is just going to send S encrypted with the key Z1 that Alice has obtained. So Alice is running some key establishment protocol and then just use the key. And we want to know whether P composed with Q is secure. So to define it a bit formally, we need to have not only parallel composition, but sequential composition. So it's P, you execute P, and then you move executing Q. So if you want to do this, of course, we have the same issues than before. Okay, so of course, we need to have no interference between the primitives. So we need to tag the standard primitives, as shown before. We can even be more general and say that P and Q, so either the primitive should be tagged to avoid interferences, or they may be disjoint, because maybe P is using Diffie-Hellman to do some key exchange protocol, and Q doesn't need Diffie-Hellman at all. You also need, as a condition two, that shared keys are not revealed. Okay, I mean, it's as before, of course. But actually, it's not sufficient. Why? Because you don't, because Q is using this the ideal Q. When you assume that keys are already established, you assume this to be perfect. In particular, if you're using two keys, you implicitly assume that they are different. So, for example, if you have a protocol Q that uses K1, K2 magically, and maybe this Q is secure, you then need a protocol to establish these two keys, K1, K2. But you don't know how P will establish the key. Maybe P will just, P is asked to establish two keys. Maybe it will just establish one secret key and then use the same key for key one, key two. Why not? It's an optimization. But then maybe Q is secure when it has two different keys, key one, key two, but maybe if the two keys collide, and here it was a stupid Q that was checking equality between keys and sending out a secret if the two keys were equal, then Q becomes clearly insecure. Okay, so you have to take into, we have to take into account that composing protocols with an active attacker interacting with P may create unexpected equalities that may yield attacks, unexpected attacks in Q. But this is basically it. So what we can show is that if you have P and Q, which just are any protocols, and then you consider an interleaving, so a composition between P and Q that we are going to call R, then if P and Q in isolation are secret, are secure, so they don't reveal a secret S, if they don't reveal each other keys, if they are tagged, and if they never instantiate two shared keys to the same value, then you can safely compose. So as an application, because this is like the generic result, how we can use it. So as an application, consider the Diffie-Hellman protocol. So a Diffie-Hellman protocol is S tends to be G to the A, and you need an authentication. So you A for Alice, for example, Mac her key, Mac J to the A with some key K0 shared between A and B. Then B would just send G to the B, and also Mac, so like yeah, authenticated. Then A can compute the shared key, because A has G to the B and can raise it to G to A, so it's J to the AB, and B has receives G to the A and can raise it to B and gets J to the AB. Okay, so this is not, resulting processes are not very nice to read, but they are quite simple. And this really models the Diffie-Hellman exchange. You send a message, you receive a new one, you raise to your own exponent. And so at the end, in the role of Alice, the resulting key is Z to the X, where Z has been received in the from B. And from the Bob point of view, the key is Z to the Y, where Z is the message received from Alice. So we have this Diffie-Hellman exchange. Then we can consider any protocol Q that is going to use some shared key, some key. So in protocols, it's often the case that we assume some long-term keys between two agents. And so here we'll have, okay, let's consider a new key. Then assume that Q1 is using key, assume that Q2 is using key. Magically, these two keys are shared between these two programs. Then we can check for this particular Q, so an easy one, where you just send Alice just send the secret encrypted with the with some long-term key to shared with Bob, and then Bob just receives the secret and store it. This is a secure protocol, and thanks to the composition theorem, we now know that these more complex protocols, where Q is using the Diffie-Hellman exchange protocol to establish the key, is itself secure. Okay. And more generally, so as soon as we have a protocol that is a key establishment protocol that ensures that the established keys are secret, as soon as you have a protocol that the ideal protocol is secure, so if the key is magically distributed, it guarantees the secrecy of some secret, XS, then you can obtain for free the composition, which is that P1, if instead of Q, because you have to get, in reality, you have to get this magically distributed key. So if Q1 first executes P1 to get something, a key, if Q2 first executed P2 to get something, the key, his view of the key, then the compose protocol still guarantees secrecy. So far, so good. We now have composition results for symmetric key establishments. Okay, so it's possible to use, Q may use any symmetric key establishment protocols, provided she doesn't reveal the keys that she's going to use. But this is about symmetric protocols. So what about now public key protocol? So going back to my Needham-Schroeder example, here I have typically assumed a PKI. Okay, I didn't tell, but I said, okay, Alice is going Bob's public key. Bob is going to use Alice's public key. Yes, but how Bob knows Alice's public key, how Alice knows Bob's public key. Here I am assuming a PKI infrastructure. I'm assuming that magically they have received each other's public key. Okay, and that's often the case. I mean, you're designing your public key protocol, you're assuming that, yeah, this is, I mean, there are works for that. I'm not going to, when I design my Needham-Schroeder protocol, I'm not going to care about how exactly keys are distributed. But what is a secure PKI? So this is still an active research domain, I think, but at the very least, what is typically assumed from a public key infrastructure? So honest agents have one public key. Okay, so if you go to a server asking my public key, you're going to get one, not 10, just one. Honest agents have pairwise distinct private keys. So my public key is different from Matteo's public keys. We're not supposed to have the same public key because we are supposed to have private keys and different ones. So to assume that keys are consistently distributed, so my view of Matteo's public key and all other keys are right. So I really know Matteo's public key. I will not confuse his key with the attacker key, for example. This is assumed implicitly. And it also assumes that my private key is private. So the attacker doesn't know my private key. So this is typically what is assumed from a PKI. Okay. So far, so good. But actually, it's not enough. I mean, it's typically what is assumed and achieved by PKI. But it's not enough as soon as you want to just use a PKI you don't know in advance. So consider, again, a simple example where Alice sends a message to Bob. So she simply sends a message M, and she signs it with her private key. Okay, so it's just signed. And in front of the message, she puts Bob's public key to make sure that Bob knows that he is the intended recipient. Okay, so Alice doesn't just sign a message M; she signs M together with the public key of Bob to indicate that Bob is the intended recipient, and this is signed. Okay, why not? And now assume that the attacker, Charlie, register, because I don't know if you made this exercise of creating your public key and registering it, but you can just send anything you want, okay? If you're honest, you're going to register a public key, a real public key for which you know the private key, but if you're dishonest, you can register anything you want. So assume that Charlie looks at Bob's public key. I mean, it's on a public repository, so you can, it's easy to see Bob's public key. And as his own public key, he says, okay, my own public key is the public key of Bob plus something, because typically you can have several size of keys. So you can say my public key is Bob's public key plus something, and this is registers as Charlie's public key. So then Charlie simply waits for Alice, the time where Alice will contact him to say something, like, I don't know, I exclude you from this group, you're fired, or whatever, I mean, something, a message. So Charlie would get a signed message from Alice, starting with his public key, PKC, the message intending to him, M. Then with this message, Charlie can impersonate Alice with respect to Bob, because his public key is Bob's public key plus something. So now Charlie can contact Bob saying, hello, I'm Alice, and here is a signed message by Alice. That means there is an official stamp on it. It's from Alice. It's intended for you. It's starting with Bob's public key. And here is the message, WM. So now Charlie can impersonate Alice. So not too often, because he's not going to register a public key too often, but he can impersonate Alice and even control the beginning of the message that he's going to send in the name of Alice to Bob. So this is one example. Another example of something that can go wrong with PKI is as follows. So consider an authority that sends to Bob a certificate saying, okay, you're Bob, here's your public key, signed by the authority. Okay, so this is typically what is done in the PKI infrastructure. You have Véronique Cortier, public key, my public key, signed by some authority. Well, for real people like me, it's not so usual, but for Amazon, or so, I mean, if you, yeah, for Amazon, for example, you have Amazon public key, signed with some signing authority. And now I assume something more weird, I have to confess. Here it's really a contrived example where Bob waits for two messages signed by the authority that are of the form X something and X something, and if these two something differs, then Bob's got completely silly and send out the message, a secret message S. So this is really contrived, doesn't make any sense, okay, it's not going to exist in real life. But the idea is that you may have a more complex protocols where, in case of some disequality, you go in some bad state, okay? And this disequality may come from the fact that two public key differ. So for honest public key, this is not going to happen. But now, of course, if the attacker registers the same public key for two people, C and D, okay, and if you, for example, for the kind of, if you are using Enigmail or this kind of, I mean, you have server where you can just register everything you want, and the server is not going to check that the same public key is never registered for two different users. So the attacker may register the same public key for two different users, and then this protocol would be insecure. So in brief, I could come up with other examples, but in brief, the issue is that PKIs do not provide any guarantee on dishonest keys. They typically provide guarantees on the honest keys, that they are consistently distributed and so on. But for people that behave dishonestly and mess up with the PKI, you have no guarantee. So what we can do? So the first option is that, Okay, so we don't know much about the PKI that is going to be used. So then we cannot analyze Needham Schroeder or all the public key protocols that have been analyzed so far as it has been done. So we cannot assume a perfect key distribution as it is typically done. So going back to the Needham Schroeder protocol, this, what is done in ProVerif, Azista, in the real tool, is typically a model like this, okay, where you analyze, you generate keys for the honest and the dishonest attacker, and you let the attacker see the dishonest keys, and then you consider A talking to B, A talking to C, blah, blah, blah. So this is really insecure. If you don't know anything about your PKI, even if it's a reasonable PKI, this is insufficient. Even if your Needham Schroeder is secure, even if your public key protocol is secure, with some, it may be insecure with some PKI. So instead, you should analyze a permissive version of the protocol. So on Needham Schroeder, to avoid all these examples I gave before, instead of analyzing your protocol where you assume your PKI to be the keys to be magically distributed, you can assume the keys to be magically distributed for the honest ones. But for the dishonest ones, you should simply let the attacker, you should reflect in your model that the attacker can mess up with the dishonest keys. So what you should analyze is a protocol where agents, honest agents, just use as a public key for a dishonest public key, just use anything that is given by the adversary. So instead of encrypting my message with Charlie's public key, I'm going to encrypt my message with anything that the attacker gives me. And the good news is that, I mean, this is another model, but it can be, for the tools, this is very easy. This can also be analyzed by tools very easily. I mean, it can be modeled very easily in Avispa, ProVerif, Citer, Tamarin, whatever. So this is your first option. Instead of analyzing protocols are as we were used to do by assuming a perfect PKI, assume more permissive protocol where dishonest keys are actually chosen by the attacker. The second option, if you don't want to redo all the analysis, then you have to be more demanding on your PKI. So not only the honest keys should be consistently distributed, but the dishonest keys should be as well, should have some guarantees. In particular, even dishonest agents should have a unique public keys, not several keys. And honest and dishonest agents, so if you take two different agents, they should have different private and public keys. So this could be done in practice by having a more demanding PKI infrastructure that cross-checks that there is no duplicates. The public key infrastructure may even ask from the agent a proof that the agent knows the corresponding secret key, for example. The other condition that we need, if we don't know anything from the PKI, then So if we don't want to redo the analysis, not only the PKI should be more stronger, so it should also guarantee properties on the dishonest keys. We should also assume that Q is not going to use keys just like this. It has to protect the keys, to encapsulate keys with tag, to make sure that you cannot confuse a public key with something else. So that's basically it. So we have these two versions. So either you can indeed compose a protocol Q with a standard PKI, but then you have to analyze a permissive Q. Or you can keep your ideal Needham Schroeder protocol, but then you have to assume that your PKI is more ideal, so guarantees properties on the dishonest keys, and moreover, public key should be tagged, And as before, processes P and Q have to be also tagged. So encryption, if they use the same encryption, this encryption should be protocol P encryption, protocol Q encryption. And we actually slightly relax, we can also slightly relax the assumption by making sure that they don't use the same key in the same schemes. Okay, so this was for PKI. But now if I go back to my imaginary discussion, let's remember that my app designer was willing to use a PKI infrastructure, password-based protocols, but also some secure channel. So here it's even worse because you don't just share data. You really run a protocol to have some functionality like a secure channel. So secure channels, there might be maybe secure channel. Many say secure channel. So here I'm considering only four. So I mean three secure and one insecure. So a secure mesh channel may be just authenticated. So you may use an authenticated channel, meaning you know from who the data is coming from. So the attacker cannot write. So this is, for example, the case of signed messages or password-based authentication. The attacker cannot impersonate. So the converse is confidential. You may want a confidential channel where the attacker cannot write. So this is, for example, the case when you encrypt, the attacker cannot encrypt with some symmetric, The attacker cannot read. So when you encrypt, the attacker cannot read. Maybe he can impersonate if it is with public key encryption. And secure is both authenticated and confidential. The attacker cannot read, cannot write. So this is really like TLS secure channel. It's a perfect channel between A and B. And finally, I mean, just to have all the combinatorics, we have public channel where the attacker can read and can write. So an example where we have this secure channel is a 3D secure protocol. So I guess all of you have used this protocol is when you go online, you do some payment, so you enter your credit card information, and then later on you have to give some numbers. And some number there are many variations of these protocols, but either it's a number that you receive on your mobile phone, or it's a challenge and you have some little card. Either it's one push button card and you just enter so it's typically an HMAC of the time and you just enter this number. So I don't know if you did, I guess you all did that once, right? I mean, when you pay, you have typically to answer some challenge to get your Amazon payment. When you look at the 3D secure specification, so it describes the user, the client, the merchant, the bank, the Visa, MasterCard stuff. It describes the communication, and it says explicitly that the communication channel has to be secure, but it doesn't give any implementation details. It just says it has to be secure. And typically, in practice, it uses TLS. But it's not part of the specification. It's an implementation choice. So it's really... Here, you could use other secure channel if you wish. But it means that when you want to analyze 3D secure, you actually need to analyze 3D secure combined with something like TLS. Okay? And so now, what is the composition pattern that we have here? So we have some protocol P that establishes some material, session keys, MAC, signature, depending on which kind of channel you want to implement. And we have this protocol Q that is in this ideal world, just assume channels. So either public channel or authenticated channel, confidential. So here we have A that starts communicating with B on some public channel, then B answers on some authenticated channel, for example, signing with this key. Then A replies on some confidential channel, maybe by encryption. And then they really interact on some secure channel. But on Q, it's left unspecified. It's just authenticated, confidential, secure, and it's left as an implementation choice. So how does the implementation look like? So the implementation So the composition that I write P dot epsilon Q. Why is this epsilon? Because, well, so okay, you run P to get some materials, some keys, MAC keys, signature, something. And then you have to embed the messages from Q. You have to embed Q's messages inside something that protects it. So in case of a public channel, it's easy. You embed it in nothing. You just send your message, easy. Then for authentication, you embed M2 in something using the material established by P. For confidential message, it's the same. You embed the message of QM3 in some encapsulation that should ensure provide confidentiality. And then for secure channel, you send your message M4, M5, M6 under some encapsulation that protects your message, and that should ensure secure channel, so the attacker cannot read, cannot write. So examples. So example of encapsulation. For authentic encapsulation, the attacker cannot write. So a typical embedding is a signature. Then you just sign X with some key established by P. For MAC, you just send X in the clear, and you MAC, so it's an HMAC, for example, here. So you HMAC X with some key received established by P. Okay, so this is typical authenticated channel. You sign or you MAC. Confidential channel, typically it's encryption. So if you need an encryption, confidential, something to encapsulate so that the attacker cannot read, well, you just encrypt your message using the public key established by your first protocol. Then for secure channel, so in TLS, so depending on which version, which sub-protocols, but then in TLS, you may simply use some symmetric key encryption and encrypt X with the key established earlier. You have the typical encrypt then sign encapsulation. So if you have no earlier, you can simply encrypt your protocol then sign it. This is also a good can read functionality. You may also do it symmetrically. So you encrypt it and you MAC it. Okay, this is another. As we're going to see later. It's what is used in the back protocol on Passport, for example. So here you have several choices. You have your composition embeds three protocols actually. So you have your protocol P that establishes data, keys, MAC keys, public keys, whatever. You have your ideal protocol Q that runs this abstract secure channel, authenticated, fully secure, confidential. And you have this encapsulation that may be secure, authenticated, or confidential. And actually, it works quite well. So if P, Q, and epsilon are tagged always, again, with different tags, if P and Q only share data only through variables, then you can indeed compose Q, so you can implement Q with any protocol P that and any encapsulation that you wish. So as an example, we have again the electronic password protocol. So if we look a bit more closely, so as you may remember, how does it work? You have to open your electronic passport, and then a key is read. And then your data are exchanged. So there are two authentication protocols, actually. Either the passive one, where we can read part of your data, or the active authentication protocol, where more data may be read from your passport. But before exchanging data between your passport and the reader, they first establish a fresh, secure channel. And this is actually the BAC, Basic Access Control Protocol. Okay, so in reality, in practice, what happens is that there is first the BAC protocol that is run to establish a key, and then the key is used as to implement a secure channel on which other protocols are run. So this is really typically a composition pattern that fits our theorem. And so not only this composition theorem gives you more flexibility in the way you can build protocol, but it also gives you more flexibility in how to analyze protocols. So here what we did is that we analyze the back protocol combined with the passive authentication protocol. So either both protocols in isolation, and then by the theorem we know that they can be composed and the composed protocol is secure. And then with the tool we used, which is the CLHC tool, part of the Avispa platform, we could reach three sessions. So we could analyze any combination of three sessions. While if you want to analyze directly the combined protocol, then you actually died at two sessions. And when you want to analyze the three protocols together, then again, thanks to the composition protocol, we can analyze them separately and reach three sessions. While if we want to directly analyze the combined protocols, then it's already quite slow at two sessions, and you again die at three. And we can do we did similar experiments on the 3D secure the combination of 3D secure the 3D secure protocol and TLS. So we can either analyze directly the combination, but then we die at one session, actually. We can not reach more than one session. Well, if we analyze them separately, then we can reach two, which also go back to the fairy tale I was telling you earlier. I mean, tools are not completely magic yet. They typically die after two or three sessions. So it really doesn't scale very well. So that's why we need to still analyze small protocols, if we analyze for a finite number of sessions. Okay. So some related work. So this idea of composition is not new. I mean, it's here for quite a long time. So, and this idea of adding a tag that I have used throughout my talk, this identifier, protocol identifier, is not new. It was one of the principles of Martin Abadi and Nidam like 20 years ago. And it has been then more formally introduced by Joshua Gutman and Tyer for composition. And then there is also, Joshua Gutman has continued his work to compose protocols, given a more general criteria. So here, what I've proposed is simple criteria that is easy to check. The approach of Joshua is to provide a more general criteria, so which is more often satisfied, but then you have to check to prove it manually for each protocol. Also, this idea of refining secure channels has been introduced by Sebastian Modersheim and Luca Vigano about 10 years ago. So they introduced this nice notation for secure channel, authentic, secure, confidential channel, and they developed this refinement, and this is actually inspired the work that I have presented today. And then going broader, so this is not just used in symbolic models, so the idea of composing has been done in cryptographic models as well, where you have this universal composability theorem. So they are not up at the stage of really composing, refining protocols, like secure channel protocols. But in the work, for example, of Ralph Kusters, they show that in cryptographic models, so models that are less abstract than the ones than symbolic models that I just presented here, you can also share keys between protocols with similar IDs, so having a session identifier or a tag that helps you differentiate between the two protocols. So the lesson learned here is that, composition is tricky. I mean, we could hope that we can put all the building blocks together. It typically doesn't work so well. Although in practice, if you take a real protocol and a real secure channel protocol and you compose them, you typically don't have flow. But we don't know if it is bad chance or if it is because protocols assume more guarantees than what is typically proved in practice. Because what is typically proved doesn't compose. And as future work, so there is many work to do yet. So first, Each time we do a composition result, we have to redo everything. While it's clear that we are using this, at least not all the same ingredient, but there are a big part that is common. So we are lacking some more general composition patterns that would capture all of them. Regarding channels, here we just consider quite simple channels. I mean, authenticated or secure, can write, can read, that's it. There are more, so first there are anonymous channels, which are more difficult to define. There's also more dynamic channels, where it's not just you establish keys, then you are using them, but it's something more dynamic. Also, here it's really for trace properties. So you prove that if you compose protocols, you preserve authentication, secrecy. You may want other properties like privacy. And privacy properties are typically modeled as equivalents. And then it's another work to upgrade all these results to equivalence properties. And as I slightly mentioned earlier, so this work is really symbolic, done in formal in formal models where we have tools. An interesting work is to see how to extend this composition to cryptographic models, which are more accurate, where there are typically no tools. But at least from a design point of view, it would be interesting to be able to compose protocols. It has already been started in the UC framework, for example. So I have 10 minutes left, so plenty of time for your questions.
When you were talking about these PKI models, your option two sort of mentioned that you assumed distinct private keys for all, basically for all the users. Doesn't this mean you have a central authority who knows all the private keys?
Let's say that the authorities know the public keys, is that your scheme is strong enough to ensure that if the public keys are distinct, then the private keys are also distinct. This is typically true because if your public key is G to the X, and if all the G to the X are distinct, then the X are almost distinct.
You still have a low probability that
Yeah. But in these symbolic models, we always assume that this low, it's the low probability doesn't appear. I mean, we abstract away any collision, typically. But still, I mean, so knowing the private keys, it's clearly unrealistic, and we don't need it. We just need an authority that knows all the public keys. But having an authority that knows all the public keys is not that easy, because public infrastructure is typically distributed. So having this global knowledge, even just on public keys, may be not realistic.
Please.
Thank you. So if I assume a quantitative model of information leakage, something like this, do some of your results get are some things easier in your framework? If I'm, yeah.
It's difficult to say, but my first guess would be no, because for example, if you move to the UC framework, which is quite different, and where we have this game. It doesn't, I mean, composition is hard as well. Assume as you shared state, you shared keys, you have to redo everything. So probably you would have different hypotheses and so on, but I don't think it would get easier.
Thank you.
Other questions?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so thanks. So I noticed that actually if the tool did not die, then the composed protocol took less time, except for one case where I think it was just about to die. So how come?
It's true only for the one session case.
Also for two sessions, except for.
Yeah, also for the, that's right. I was surprised too. It's probably because we have to rerun the experiment. So when we analyze the protocols in isolation, we actually run the protocol, the tools three times. And apparently for small protocols, whether you, so doing it three times takes more time than doing it with someone which is slightly larger once.
Okay, thanks.
So I have a couple of questions, which are partly anticipated by your last slide. So the first one is about confidentiality. So you were mentioning indeed that an interesting direction is actually to somehow transfer these results from the symbolic to the real cryptographic computational setting. So you mostly focused on confidentiality, which is expressed symbolically in a way that is different from the cryptographic setting, which is mostly indistinguishability based. So I was wondering whether you have a feeling about actually that whether or not the tagging technique that you proposed does actually enforce the standard, let's say, confidentiality definition in the crypto setting, although there are no formal results yet, just as a gut feeling whether this result would actually work or not.
It's unclear because, for example, being secure in cryptographic models is typically harder, so you have to. So, as you mentioned, confidentiality is not just leakage, full leakage of the data, is just knowing one bit of the data. So you could hope for the fact that if Q is secure, it's actually more secure. Maybe our security notion in a symbolic model is weak, and maybe that's why it doesn't compose well. So this is one reason to hope that it would compose better in in a computational model. On the other hand, the counterexample that we found, they are contrived, but they capture the essence of the problem. And I guess we have the same issue. I mean, these counterexamples are still counterexamples in the cryptographic models. The second issue with cryptographic models is that they are typically worse than us on symbolic side on dishonest keys. I mean, for example, the idea that business keys are honestly generated and then generously given to the attacker is the typical model. So the way they handle dishonest keys or dishonest agent, dishonest channel, is somehow even more ideal in cryptographic models than in symbolic ones. And so we would need to rework probably the cryptographic definition to extend this work to cryptographic models.
Okay, and another question. So you focused on confidentiality. Does this tagging discipline kind of give you more general trace-based properties? For instance, a common property that is used in cryptographic protocol analysis are correspondence assertions. So before reaching a certain point in the protocol, this other point should have been reached. This is message dependent. Do you get compositionality also for such general trace-based properties or not?
So for some of the result, the result holds not only for confidentiality, but also for correspondence properties, for example, for parallel composition or for the PKI. And for the rest, it's not proof, but yes, we believe it does. You just have to extend slightly the result here and there. And it's also where we are missing this general pattern composition, because also, you know, sometimes I lie to us, to you, because sometimes the results just hold when you share standard primitives and they're tagged. Sometimes you are also free to use other primitives in addition, provided they are disjoint. But if you take the four results, it's not always the same. Sometimes it's just the standard one, sometimes it's just disjoint one, sometimes it's all together. In my opinion, everything works in the general case. So you tag shared primitives and you do anything you want. You do correspondence properties as well as confidentiality properties. It's not proved, so maybe it doesn't. But intuitively, it does.
Okay. Yes.
So, as you said earlier, it's not reasonable to assume some kind of guarantees on the public keys. Are there works actually doing probabilistic stuff? So assuming that you have a probability that the public keys are similar or identical, and then computing the probability that you lose the secret.
So for public key, typically, I would say that if you want to go for probabilities, you really should consider the cryptographic models, where it's typically this. I mean, the attacker is any probabilistic Turing machine, and may generate keys at random if it's better for him, or deterministically if it's better for him. And then you compute the probabilities that your secret is leaked, or that the correspondence property is false. So cryptographic models are quantitative.
I wonder, what is the state of the art when it comes to implementation? How can we guarantee that the implementation is confidential? So, as far as I understand, now the models are written in some p-calculus, and how to transfer to implementation, and what guarantees now we have for TLS and TCD secure, for example?
So that's a good question and a typical question. I mean, we have all these guarantees on the specification. Then what about the implementation? Because many flaws arise on the implementation. So clearly, the tools are not up to verifying any implementation. They are far from this. But there is, for example, the project from Kartik Bhargavan with MyTLS, where it's not. The idea is not that you will be able to verify any implementation, because this is huge, but they are implementing a reference implementation of TLS called MILE-TLS in a language that they can prove. So it's in F-sharp with annotation. In some cases, even discharge part of the proof to Proverif. And so they do develop proved TLS implementation. And that's also how they find many flaws, actually. Because they have to dig into the details of TLS and find out why their reference implementation doesn't fulfill the properties. So the current stage is that, okay, all the tools doesn't scale to implementation, clearly. You see they die at three sessions. For the tools that do a finite number of sessions, they die at three sessions on the specification. But there are projects to develop implementations that can be proved.
Other questions? Okay, if not, let's thank Veronique again for the very interesting tutorial.